It's always super humbling for me when a client chooses to share their story with the goal to help others make more informed decisions while traversing the criminal justice system. To that end, I'm so proud to welcome my good friend and client, Dr. Nate Schott, to our channel today. Thank you, Nate.
Thank you. I'm so glad to be here, Justin. Thanks for inviting me and letting me share my story.
Thank you so much. Let's just jump right in and talk a little bit about what it was like for you and your family before retaining white-collar advice as you were traversing your investigation for a white-collar crime.
You know, it was the biggest way to just say it was a nightmare. It was terrible. We felt like we were in the pressure cooker, and we really were. We felt very good about our representation. Our lawyers were good. We felt good about them. But there were parts of the process that I didn't know anything about. I didn't understand how to get through it, because the lawyers were so good about getting us, you know, up to that point to where we made the deal with the government, or the government presented us a deal and the things that we had to do. They were great about that, but there was a whole nother side of that when we got to the pre-sentencing part and the part we have to fill everything out and have family and friends put letters in, and, you know, what to expect during prison and how to navigate that prison and, you know, really do what you say so many times in your videos and in everything you put out, is how to prepare for the best possible outcome. And that was something that I so worried about, because I was used to always doing that, even in my business life and my personal life. What could I do to prepare myself for anything that I got into? And that world was just so unknown. So before I got into that with White Collar Advice and with you and your team, you know, we felt like we were just skating in the dark. We couldn't see anything. And I mean, our lawyers, as I said, were very good. But when you guys got involved, it was just a huge, huge change for us.
So I remember our first conversation. It was December 2019. I was actually going for a walk with my dad. My dad is committed to walking, and he still has since then. So my dad and I were going for a walk. We spoke, and I really early into the call, you said, Justin, I know some lawyers may be against this. I have no idea why, but I have really good lawyers. I work well with them. They're totally supportive of having your team come on board. I thought that was so helpful that you addressed it with them. You weren't seeking their permission. You said, This is a decision I'm going to make. I want you to support it. And they did. But I really applaud you for just mentioning that you had very good lawyers, and you told them that our team was going to come on. I think before we even agreed to work together, I think we knew that it was a fit. Let's touch on, because I know lawyers have their role, the sentencing memorandum, negotiating the plea, and they did a very good job in your case. With respect to white-collar advice, what do you think some of the specific problems you were hoping our team would help solve?
How to do best to get better, less sentence for us, and you did. I mean, you absolutely did. I think you know part of my story, but the government was going for 51 months, and I ended up with a 33-month sentence, and my crime was a conspiracy to commit healthcare fraud. So it was, and finding out after being in prison that is very uncommon in many instances. In other instances, you know, the judge doesn't depart downward. He or she may depart upward sometimes. And I found out when I got to prison that I was so well prepared because of, I believe, what my lawyers did, but really a lot of things what you guys did and how you did it leading up to the sentencing, from getting the letters together, from going through setting me up for RDAP and how to deal with that, and all of my helping me get the evaluations that I needed, that I already had, you know, that issue. It wasn't something that we made up, but just telling the truth about and how to put that in writing so not only the judge would see it, but the biggest thing is after you deal with the judge on it, the judge could recommend RDAP, but that doesn't really sway whether you get into the program or not. All of the things that you do before that and how you set it up with your doctors and, you know, what you all helped me do and attain helped me know that I was going to get into RDAP. And that was a wonderful thing. And that was something that set me up to shave time off of my sentence that I never thought I would be able to do.
Something I recall from our early conversations, and part of the reasons I think you had excellent lawyers, some lawyers may have this very well a God complex, where every idea has to originate from them, even if they may think it's a great idea. If it didn't come from their mind, they dismiss it. Your lawyers understood that there are things they're paid to do well as lawyers, But I think they also understood, and this comes from interviews we've done with federal judges, or I put up two recent sentencing videos, including one last week from Judge Carter, where he opened up the sentencing hearing, speaking about literally reading excerpts from our client's narrative. So I think you and your lawyers understood there's things that I have to do to convey why I'm worthy of leniency, and there are things the lawyers can do. And if you put them together, it can lead to a significantly shorter outcome. You mentioned 51 months to 33 months. We got you home in 10 months. Let's transition to, I know when I ask this question, the answer is the internet. But when you started your search and looking for guidance, why white collar advice? Was it specifically I said, Michael Santos said? There are options. Help our audience understand where you started your search and why you thought our team was the right team.
Professionalism is the one thing that I come down to. Now, not saying that the other groups aren't professional at all, but it was through the internet. I mean, I started watching YouTube videos like probably most of your viewers are doing right now and wondering, oh my gosh, what's this going to be like? What's going to happen? And scoured that. But I kept coming back to you, and it wasn't a formula, but your connectivity, and you seemed to want to tailor it to each individual client. I mean, I think I had talked to you about RDAP, and because I had heard about it, and I think one of the first things I said is, how do I get into that? And you first says, well, we have to see first if you're able to do it. Mm-hmm. It wasn't like you were going to manufacture something that wasn't true, not that the other people were, but you put everything in place. And you know, that was one of the biggest things that I really liked about you. You know, you said you've got to see if you qualify for that first, Nate. And if you do, then you can get in. If you don't, you don't. And I like that. I mean, I didn't think, because so many consultants out there use RDAP and other things. Oh, we can get you time off, and people are making stuff up. And quite honestly, I'll tell you, they find out in prison if you're making it up or not. I mean, and especially in that program, it's not an easy program. It's one of the hardest things I've been through in my life, and I've done a lot of difficult things, but they spend so much time with you, and you're in an enclosed environment, i.e. prison, where nothing is a secret. You know, they find things out, so you've got to be prepared for the way that you go in and be truthful and honest, and that was the way that you were able to help me the best, is being truthful, being open, being honest. But in answering your question, I see it going back to, it was the internet, and I really think your professionalism and the things that you put stuff out, the people that you had interviewed, it seemed to me more real, and I found out that it was. I mean, everything that you said to me with putting me with people to talk to, and asking, you know, if what do I need, and finding that out. I mean, you couldn't do it for me, but you guys paved a way that made it so much easier, and it gave my family and myself a calmness that I didn't have leading up to that point.
Nate, what I want to talk about for a moment is the power of your personal narrative. You were very involved in that process, and once it was completed, I think it helped propel you to begin sharing your story with more people in your community, because there is fallout and people read. There was a lot of press around your case. I think the guilty plea and the sentencing, Dr. Nate Schott, the entrepreneur.
There was a whole lot. Yeah, so, it was everywhere. It went all the way to the West Coast and New York and Florida too. So it was unbelievable.
So let's talk about how you began to manage the narrative by virtue of the narrative we created and sharing it with your community, not running from this as a sense of embarrassment and shame, but rather good people can make bad choices. It's what we do to overcome them. So I'd like you to offer some insights and frankly some inspiration on how you lived leading up to sentencing, because as you know, some people can't get out of bed. They can't brush their teeth. They put on weight like I did, and they make bad decisions. So talk about how you began to gain strength, hopefully with the help of White Collar Advice, leading up to sentencing and into prison.
Well, I liked what you said. You know, good people sometimes make bad decisions. And with you guys helping me, I mean, Your whole team was phenomenal. I could call you at any time, and the other people on your team I could talk to, and I would quite honestly do that. But you know, it gets down to owning my story and what I did and not running from it. Finding where my truth was and staying to the truth and owning that truth. And you know, that's something I still do today. That is hard to do sometimes, but not so much anymore, because you know, my actions don't define me as a person, or one or two actions that happen. And I've learned that. You all helped me see that. The other thing that helped me see that, because of what you put in place, the way that you helped me gather my narratives was really tremendous, because you start hearing what other people not just think of you, but they know of you. And it doesn't negate all of those years that I was together, what I had been as a father and a friend and a business person and as a community member. And you drew that out of people, but it let me see from their eyes what they thought of me. So that helped me tremendously. And I want to say thank you for that, because that was something that I had to, I remember I would cling onto a lot of times on those lonely nights when you're lying in bed and you're just thinking, am I really that person or am I really that bad? And, you know, I wasn't that bad. I made a mistake, and I made mistakes, and getting through it and living in that was, you get up each morning and I would get out of bed. If I needed to call you, I would call you. If I called Brad a lot of times, you know, one of the guys on your team, he would talk and encourage and just be there to do that. The other people you put me with that had been through it and actually had been through prison, you know, several of those guys, and I think several you've had on your show too, you know, your channel. And they were phenomenal. I mean, encouraging and being there, giving me the ins and outs of what was going to happen. But as far as living in my community, you know, I was actually more free once all of it came out and it happened. And it was like, okay, I can live with this. I can deal with it. And I'm able to. But you guys were a big part of that. So that was very helpful.
For everyone watching, there's some good and bad that comes with the Department of Justice press releases. Of course, the bad is, oh my goodness, it's out there. Right. The good is it requires you to take some action or to try to change the narrative. Now, in some cases, I've shared the story that I was exploited. I pulled out my credit card and paid $16,000 to a reputation management firm that exploited me because they promised to remove these press releases. I didn't understand at the time that I could, it's going back a long time now to 2006, right. I didn't understand that I could try to manage the narrative. I was lost. So the good is it could require you to take the right action. The bad sometimes is when defendants reach out and say, well, I haven't had the press release. I don't know if anything's ever going to come from it. So I'm going to kind of live like the ostrich or pretend this isn't happening because nobody knows. Yet in the world of Google, with or without a release, inevitably it comes out. And if you're not managing that narrative, then you're behind and you've wasted time. I mean, I shared the story of a few days ago, a very nice woman in Illinois called, and she's been following our videos for more than a year. Read the books, no press. Lawyer told her it's too early to take action, relax. And of course, once you get indicted, that probably means it's not too early, but he said do nothing. And now it's like, wow, it's here. And she regrets she's done nothing for the last year. So I would just like you to reiterate the importance of, whether you have the press release or not, of beginning to change the narrative and how it can empower a defendant.
Well, the issue that I dealt with was, is I had a family, I had a wife, and I have kids that, you know, thank God they stayed with me through it. But, you know, there's another life to live. They're going through it with you, and they count on you, or they did on me in many ways, to, you know, still be present. And, you know, I went through those days, as you said, where I wanted to be an ostrich and put my head in the sand and, you know, put it in the ground and stay in the bed and not get out. But it helped me start looking to life. What was it going to be afterwards? Because there is a life after. Mm-hmm. And it started that process in me for personal healing. Not that my wife couldn't do it. My kids couldn't do it. My church couldn't do it. I had to go through that and started owning where I was, and it started that narrative, and it gave me strength, I believe, to really get, when I got into prison, to be a lot more stronger than I was before I entered it. So you guys helped that part of my narrative, but it came to terms with where I was, who I was, and what I needed to do to get through it, if that makes sense at all.
It does make sense. A few more questions here as we continue. Is there anything that surprised you about working with our team, both good or bad? I'd love to know anything surprised or shocked you.
It really is a team. I mean, when you guys start into it, I mean, you're ready to go. It's not, you know, it's not just you taking a call. And I mean, you've got everybody from the you know, whether it's psychologists to people that help you write the narratives, mm-hmm. to what's going to happen when we get to prison. I mean, I talk to you quite a bit. But I also talked to so many other people on your team that were so ready and willing to do it. And it was just a phone call away. And that helped me a lot. I mean, I did never have a problem getting somebody or getting to somebody.
What's interesting how before I think you worked with our team, then of course, while working together, you spoke with clients. And for everyone watching, we really try to embrace the pay it forward mantra, because now Nate is speaking both with clients, but also I have frequently said we are proponents of white collar advice of due diligence. Many people with whom we work don't need to speak with clients or clients from the past. Some say, hey, this sounds great. I think I'd like to speak with someone. Totally cool with that. So Nate has spoken with myriad prospects who are now clients about our work and our process. To that end, if someone's considering working with us, is there advice that you would give them as we engage in our relationship together?
Run, don't walk is my first thing I say to you guys. Especially, I would say, I wished I had gotten there a little bit earlier. I got there right after, if you recall, that December, that November, we had just signed our agreement with the U.S. government, you know, with the U.S. attorneys, and it was about 2 weeks afterwards. And that was, I mean, my lawyers, like you said, they didn't say I didn't need it, but we can handle it up to here. But finding out, I mean, without you all and opening my eyes to RDAP and how to do that, my lawyers weren't going down that road. And I can tell you, I got out of prison in 10 months on a 33-month sentence. In many ways, yes, they got I believe the 33 months were there. You all were a huge part of that. But in many ways, I believe that was because of what you helped me set up and put things in motion before I got there. And I owe that to you. But what I would say is, you know, at least talk to you guys. Don't just keep surfing the internet. I've talked to some people, you know, through my lawyer, they would surf the internet and they would find out all this information. It's so much bigger than that. It's so much more than that. The narratives you have many of your the conversations that you have on YouTube or your channel about getting prepared and how important the narrative is. I think those are what really got me the time going down, the way you all did it and how you did it and the way you helped the people speak the narrative for me and capture it. So it's a lot bigger than just writing this down and say, oh, I'm going to get into RDAP to get time off. That's not really it. I mean, you're bigger. You all talk about more than that. I mean, getting into RDAP is such a small part of it, if you even qualify for it. But you've had clients where you've done work for them and, you know, they stay at home. They don't even get sentenced. Is don't try to do it on your own. I mean, and I promise you, you will, when you sit in prison, you would be willing to pay anything if you got out a month or two early. So pay it now, you know, if you can.
So let's talk about prison in a moment. And before I transition to prison, there's a documentary this is March 8th, and there's a documentary coming out on March 17th on Netflix around the Varsity Blues case. And I participate in that documentary, and I don't know if this question will air in the documentary, if they'll show it. You know, they interview you for 4 hours and they put you on there for 75 seconds is the way it works sometimes.
Yeah.
But they ask why my company is white collar advice versus federal prison advice or some other name, which is fine, but why white collar advice? And part of it is because so much of the work that we do doesn't have to do with federal prison, but what does the rest of your life look like with a felony conviction before? And of course, the hardest part may be coming home. And I know on one of our calls, I said, Nate, whether you serve 10 months, 20 months, 30 months, 40 months, 50 months, the hardest part can be coming home with a sullied reputation, especially you've been a physician, you need to make money, you've had licenses, you have a family, you're used to living a good life. So for those of you watching, yes, Nate got home in 10 months. I want you to get home as quickly as possible. But what I don't want is, my goodness, I got home as quickly as possible. That's wonderful. What do I do now? How do I support my family and pay my health insurance? These are the decisions you have to put in place before you go in, as Nate did. Nate, as we wrap up this interview, I'd love to learn a little bit about your life on the inside. Were you productive? Did you avoid problems? Let me shut up for a few minutes and listen about your life at Montgomery Federal Prison Camp.
Everything you said to do, I really did. Stayed out of the TV room, read a lot. I was accepted into the RDAP program, so that kept me busy and keeps you busy. You know, you're really part of a community there. It's a modified therapeutic community, they call it. So you do that, exercised a lot, but really tried to I didn't stay to myself as much as I probably would have liked because of RDAP. I mean, they bring you into a community and you really get to know one another. However, even within that, I stayed out of problems. I really got to know what to expect before I got there. through you, through Brad, mm-hmm. through the other people on your team, and then through the guys that you put me through, like myself, that are talking to clients or potential clients of yours that talk to me a lot about it. I mean, I've got one guy that's a really good friend of mine, and since that, and he was your client before, and we've only talked on the phone, I mean, for 2 years now. Mm-hmm. But he was somebody that helped me say, do this, don't do that. He'd actually been at Montgomery. So he helped me there. I had a job. I drove a tractor. Then I moved into the electrical department. But daily, it was I did exactly what you said. Start preparing for your exit when you enter. And I really wanted to do that. So I read a lot of books. I wrote a lot of things. I did business plans. I got ideas together. I corresponded with, you know, friends that would correspond with me, which most people would. You know, when I got out. So I took your advice very much, and it proved very well. I mean, I really believe that's what one of the many reasons, but one of the other reasons that got me there, I wasn't a problem prisoner. I got out of in there. I did my time, and I was out in 10 months on a 33-month sentence, and it wasn't COVID related. I mean, everybody says, oh, it was COVID. I went in to be put in for COVID, and they said, no, Schott, your sentence is, you know, you're done. We already put you in. You know, you're not, you don't even qualify for COVID. So I was like, great. And I came back and it was like, wow, I got up, you know, I'm going home, you know, right, almost right after I finished the RDAP program. So I was very grateful for that. And I really owe much of that and most of that to you all and your team. It was amazing.
Well, I'm incredibly grateful for this review. I have one final question for you. Is there anything else, in addition to everything you've so eloquently said, anything else you'd like to comment about or say about working with white collar advice, or just any other advice you'd give to somebody watching this video,
yeah,
going through a tough spot?
I would tell them, don't give up hope. There is help out there, and you know, take the plunge. I promise you, it will be well worth it. If you can get a lesser sentence or get out earlier, spend the money now and hire white collar advice, because I don't believe you'll regret it. Because if you get out earlier or get your sentence reduced, all those things, you're going to be able to make that money up so much quicker. Your life's going to be better. You're going to get back to your loved ones. And as you know, the longer folks are in, you know, the things that happen to their marriages, everything that goes on in their life and coming out, it changes them. So I hope that the folks listening to this would you know, run and get to you guys as quickly as they can. So
thank you. And let's go through that math one more time for everyone watching the guidelines. The government asked for 51 months at Nate's sentencing. By way of his mitigation, both with the lawyers and our team, he worked in, none of this works, by the way, unless you're willing to work hard and invest the time, right? So there may be some bad days throughout this process, but on an overarching theme, you worked at it every single day. So they ask for 51 months, you get sentenced to 33 months, you surrender to prison, and based on avoiding problems, completing the program, good time, and everything that accompanies that, you served a total of 10 months on a 33-month sentence.
That's right. And then I had 10 months of home confinement, which would have been halfway house, which that's the way it was considered. And I just finished my halfway house time, and I am on probation.
You are on probation, and I'm so happy about that. And it's so wonderful to see you. And our whole team, from Michael Santos to Brad, everyone, we're grateful you've taken the time to share this testimonial. We know you're busy. And I hope people watching will follow your lead, take action day by day, hold the lawyer accountable. And if they do that, they position themselves not just to get a shorter sentence, but to have a more productive life on the other side.
That's right. Thank you, Justin.
Thank you again.
It was phenomenal.
Thanks,
buddy.